So, welcome to week three of Bible Month 2021. Now, last year in Bible Month, we kept company with Ruth. There are four chapters in Ruth, which is very convenient for Bible Month. The year before that, we'd worked our way through Paul's letter to Christians in Colossae. There are four chapters in Colossae, so that too was very convenient. Way back in 2018, we got first too wet and then too dry with Jonah. And yes, there are four chapters in the book of Jonah. And some of us began to wonder where we were going to go when we ran out of short biblical books that divided neatly into four. And it turned out that we were going to Mark's Gospel. Mark's Gospel has 16 chapters. At least we can easily lop 16 into four equal parts, even as we struggled with too much stuff in each of the four quarters. Except that's not how it works. It might surprise you to learn that the divisions of the Bible into chapters and verses is essentially modern. Well, relatively modern. The system of chapters that we use was devised by Archbishop of Canterbury, Stephen Langton, in the early 13th century, but the verses came much later and are first found in the Geneva Bible of 1576, the earliest mechanically printed, mass-produced Bible in English that was available to the English-speaking, English-reading public. The Geneva Bible was the Bible of William Shakespeare and Oliver Cromwell and of the three Johns, John Knox in Scotland, John Donne, and John Bunyan, and is the Bible that first reached America on the Mayflower. And of course, dividing the Bible into chapters and verses enables the reader to find their place, and we'd be lost, wouldn't we, without them. But the divisions are essentially artificial. And cutting a 16-chapter book into four equal parts is not the way to go. Now, Mark is the earliest of the Gospels. Even so, Mark was written more than a generation after the events that the Gospel tells us about. When Matthew and Luke wrote their Gospels, they each had in front of them a written copy of Mark. How do I know? There are around 660 verses in Mark's Gospel. I say around because there are alternative endings. Perhaps we'll learn more about that next week. Of those 660 verses, 600 of them, that's 90% of them, appear essentially unchanged in Matthew, and 450 of them, almost 70%, found their way into Luke. But it was Mark who first set out to bring everything together in a connected form. He had this huge collection of building blocks, like the biggest Lego set that you could ever imagine. And Mark's genius was in design and construction, joining the building blocks together, sometimes with an absolute minimum of mortar as thin as then or immediately, which we've learned, of course, is one of Mark's most favorite words. So if dividing Mark's continuous narrative into verses is artificial, then carving Mark up according to the chapter numbers is doubly artificial. So instead of week three presenting us with chapters 9, 10, 11, and 12, which on the face of it would appear to be neat and tidy, instead our portion of Mark for this week begins in the middle of chapter 8 and takes us to the end of chapter 10. And we're going to find that that makes complete sense. But before we go any further down that road, we need to turn to our opening responses and our affirmation of faith. We say the words in blue together, and I get to say the words in yellow. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. One thing I have asked of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. Who is it that you seek? We seek the Lord our God. Do you seek him with all your heart? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your soul? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your mind? Amen. Lord, have mercy. Do you seek him with all your strength? Amen. Christ, have mercy. To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Amen. So we singing the Faith 161, speak, O Lord, as we come to you.
Thank you.
God, faithful and true, you call every generation to make a pilgrim journey. Guide our feet in the way of faith, that we may put our whole trust in you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It never occurred to Mark that people like us would read his gospel aloud in bite-sized chunks on a Sunday morning. After all, it's the chapter and verse numbers that make a lectionary even possible. But Mark was writing a continuous narrative. So here's a challenge for Bible Month. 660 verses is not a big read. It's just 20 pages in my workaday Bible. So how about in this week, reading it in one sitting? Make sure that you're not going to be interrupted. Turn the phone off. Sit in a comfortable chair. This one is courtesy of a well-known Swedish furnishing company. Make sure everything you could possibly need is to hand and that the light is right. And have with you a notebook and a pen so that you can make a note of anything that you came across but didn't expect to find, and a note of anything that you did expect to find but it wasn't there. And finally, make a note of anything that you actually found interesting. Then you might actually hear what Mark is setting out before us today. We're going to hear the first of the two gospel readings today, and I found a video, a dramatic version of this reading, which is completely true to the scriptures, so we can sit back and let others read for us.
They came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, "Do you see anything?" He looked up and said, "I see people. They look like trees walking around." Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly. Jesus sent him home saying, "Don't even go into the village."
The worksheets for children and anyone who gets bored in the service and needs to be distracted, they've been circulated. The one you can see on the left is, in fact, it has a slider going through the face so that you can actually give expression to the toast, "Here's mud in your eye." At the end of last week's portion of the gospel, Jesus challenges his disciples, "Do you not perceive or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes and fail to see? Do you have ears and fail to hear and do not yet understand?" And Mark illustrates this challenge with today's section of Mark's gospel, which begins, "They came to Bethsaida," and the healing of a blind man. And it ends with, "They came to Jericho." Precisely the same words Mark expects us to notice. In Bethsaida, Jesus heals a blind man. In Jericho, what does Jesus do but heal a blind man? It wasn't a coincidence. Mark constructed it precisely in that way. So today's portion of Mark's gospel is bookended with healings of blind people. On the face of it, two similar stories, and yet they are quite different from each other. And in between the two healings, Jesus and his disciples are constantly on the move. There's a lot of geography in these 118 verses. In Bethsaida, the healing is a gradual process. Jesus takes the blind man by the hand and leads him away from the crowd. He puts saliva on his eyes and lays hands on him. Can you see anything? I see people like trees walking. So Jesus has another go, and eventually the man saw everything clearly. And then what happened? He was sent straight home. He was told, go straight home, do not pass go, do not even go into the village. It's part of what scholars call the messianic secret. In Mark, every time somebody says, I know who you are, Jesus says, shush, don't tell anybody. And from Bethsaida, Jesus and his disciples went to Caesarea Philippi. That's the furthest north that Jesus ever went. There, Peter at least seemed to have a spiritual breakthrough. You are the Messiah, he told Jesus. And Jesus, as you would expect, says, shush, don't tell anybody. But then Peter immediately messes it up again. And Jesus declares Peter's thinking to be badly focused. And then comes, quite literally, a high point. Jesus took Peter, James, and John up a mountain. Perhaps it was Mount Hermon. Perhaps it was Mount Tabor. Mark doesn't actually tell us, because it actually doesn't matter. This was a theological mountain as the setting for a theological high point. What matters is that Jesus was transfigured, and long dead characters full of import and significance, Moses and Elijah, are seen talking with him. And Peter is so overwhelmed by the experience that he starts babbling until a heavenly voice cuts to the chase. It's the second heavenly voice in Mark. The first was for Jesus' ears alone after his baptism. This one is for disciples' benefit. Just how many opportunities do they need for seeing Jesus, for ascertaining his person and his mission? But down the mountain, the rest of them were failing to get it, so he took them all home to Capernaum to debrief them, and still they did not understand. He put a little child in the middle of them as an object lesson to those who were arguing which of them was the greatest. Let's sing again, singing the faith 244. Blessed are the pure in heart.
Thank you.
Jesus and the company of disciples did what Judeans routinely did without thinking. They crossed the River Jordan to come down the other side of the Rift Valley rather than pass through Samaria. And on the way, James and John decided to play for high stakes. "What is it you want me to do for you?" Jesus asks. He's been talking to them about crosses, and their heads are full of thrones. And so comes, quite literally, the low point of the story. They came to Jericho, down by the Dead Sea, the lowest point on the surface of the earth. And as they were leaving to begin the long haul up to Jerusalem, to climb up 3,000 feet, not just Jesus and his disciples, but a large crowd, a blind beggar was sitting by the roadside. That blind man way back in Bethsaida was not named, and Jesus took him away from the others and told him not to talk about what had happened. But in Jericho, the blind man is named. He's called Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus. So let's watch a video of his story. It's a cartoon, I know, but it's a cartoon that is very true to the gospel. Mark 10, 46 to 52.
Jesus led his disciples through the town of Jericho. As they were leaving, a large crowd gathered around him. Then, from the midst of the crowd, a voice came out.
"Jesus, son of David, please help me."
The voice belonged to a blind beggar named Bartimaeus. He was sitting by the road because he heard that Jesus from Nazareth was walking by.
"Jesus, son of David, please help me."
The blind man continued to cry out. Many people scolded the blind man and told him to be quiet.
"Would someone tell that blind man to keep it down?"
"Yeah, we're trying to comfortably enjoy Jesus, man."
"Indeed, this blind man is totally ruining the vibe."
"Be quiet, you."
But Bartimaeus shouted more and more.
"Jesus, son of David! Please help me! Please help me!"
Jesus stopped.
"Tell the man to come here."
So they called the blind man.
"Cheer up! Get to your feet! Jesus is calling you!"
Bartimaeus stood up quickly. He left his coat there and went to Jesus.
"What do you want me to do for you?"
"Teacher, I want to see again."
"Go. You are healed because you believed."
At once, the man was able to see again, and he followed Jesus on the road. Jesus gave blind Bartimaeus his sight. Jesus is the light of the world. Everyone is born spiritually blind, but through him, we can see. Jesus shines his light in the darkness of our lives. He can make the blindest heart see.
When James and John had come to Jesus with their outrageous request for thrones of glory, Jesus had asked them, "What do you want me to do for you?" Now he asked the same question of Bartimaeus. "What do you want me to do for you?" "My teacher, I want to see." There's nothing gradual about this healing, because this blind man is the one person in the story who actually sees. He recognizes Jesus unequivocally. Son of David, have mercy on me. And when they tried to shut him up, he simply got louder. Jesus assured him that his faith had made him well, and immediately he regained his sight. The man at Bethsaida had been sent home in private. Here in Jericho, Bartimaeus followed Jesus on the way. He literally followed Jesus. Have no doubt about it. When the crowds in Jerusalem on Palm Sunday shouted their hosannas, Bartimaeus was amongst them. And he, as you would expect, is shouting as loudly as any of them, because he got it. He actually saw Jesus. We're going to sing again from Songs of Fellowship. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. In a couple of weeks, we're planning to resume our exploration of the life of the early church in the book of Acts. Seems a long time ago that we suspended it in order to follow the calendar of the church. You might recall that when Barnabas found Paul in Tarsus, the two of them taught together there in Antioch for the year. And then we get this wonderful throwaway line in the book of Acts. It was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. So by the time Mark wrote his gospel, the followers of Jesus had been called Christians for some time. But before that, they were known as followers of the way. Followers of the way of Jesus. There's a memory of that in the story of Bartimaeus, the blind beggar of Jericho, the one who actually saw the truth about Jesus. Mark says of him, he followed Jesus on the way. There are those who will tell you that if you cannot recite the time and the place of your conversion, then you are not a real Christian. But that isn't so. To be a Christian is not to have arrived. To be a Christian is to be following Jesus on the way. And following on that way is a lifelong process for which we need to acquire long-time skills. So let us turn to our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Open our eyes, Lord, so that you constantly surprise us, answering our prayers in ways we had not asked or thought, changing people and their lives beyond all expectation, giving us joy in you in the face of evil and suffering, bringing hope out of despair, health out of sickness, life out of death. In a world that is stale with bad news, open the eyes of leaders and governments to a vision of the future where the nations will be ruled with justice, wisdom, and care. On this World Refugee Day, we pray for those who have fled from their homes and their possessions to wander in the world as refugees because of the dangers of staying at home. Open our eyes to see the plight of the hungry. Open our ears to hear the cries of the distressed. Open our hands to give where help is needed. Open our hearts to love as you first loved us. We pray for those for whom COVID is a constant threat, praying especially today for the people of Brazil, because 500,000 Brazilians have died because of COVID, and they have a president who plays down the pandemic. Open our eyes to your spirit within our churches, disturbing us, changing us, pulling and pushing us on. Surprise us again, Lord. Open our eyes, Saviour, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And a prayer to follow Christ. Lord Jesus, you did not come into the world for the sake of being ministered to, nor surely to be worshipped in the sense of being admired. You yourself are the way and the truth. You call us to be followers, not admirers. Open our eyes if we have dozed off into delusion. Save us from going astray by wishing merely to admire you, when what is needful is to follow you and be made like you. Amen. We'll say the Lord's Prayer in the contemporary version. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. A final hymn is again from Singing the Faith, 673, and it's the version produced by our own singers and musicians. Will you come and follow me?
it to what I mean in you and you in me. When you love the new you heard in life, adore your name. Will you quell the fear inside and never be the same? Will you use the faith you hold to reshape the world around through my sight and touch and sound in you and you? Lord, your summons echoes true when you but call my name. Let me turn and follow you and never be the same. In your company I'll go, where your love and footsteps show. Thus I'll move and live and grow in you and you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Michael, indeed, for your sharing with us. We look forward to a fourth chunk of those chapters and verses, as you've described, arbitrarily assigned in Mark with John next week. We're hoping that will be led from Holgate Methodist Church using their new camera by John. So I'm hoping it's gone well this morning for you over at Holgate, and you're feeling confident of that. We'll have a dry run, but we'll have a backup strategy in case, because we know how these things work when we're learning as we go along. Just another notice that this coming week, I think, is it 20th of July, next one. Oh, is that supposed to be June? Mm. Is Anne on the call?
Yeah, that's true. We had our June one last Tuesday.
Last Tuesday, okay.
Yeah, we're now into July, and I've started to think about the input there for the 20th of July.
Okay, so 20th of July for your diaries. Thank you very much. And we will be having a break for the summer for pre-warning to give Anne some rest and recuperation, but we hope you'll join that. Before I hand back to Michael for the final blessings and prayers, I just wondered whether there's anybody wants to reflect or share anything from any of the churches. So I'm giving the tech guys a hard time by asking that question. Or anybody on the call?
I think we should congratulate Charlie and Tom for the way that the tech has worked today. I think they've done exceptionally well.
It does feel that way, doesn't it? Yeah, and we're still on the learning curve, and I made some changes just this morning that they had to cope with. So we thank them very much. They've done a great job. From here, it came across very well. So I look forward to hearing how it came across in each of our different venues. We move onwards and upwards, don't we? And as we worship together. So Michael, we'll hand back to you for the final bit of the service, and then I'll come back and we'll do the breakout rooms.
Thank you, Andy. So we turn to our canticle, our final responses, and the blessing. We say together, Christ as a light, illumine and guide me. Christ as a shield, overshadow me. Christ under me, Christ over me. Christ beside me, on my left and my right. This day be within and without me, lowly and meek, yet all-powerful. Be in the heart of each to whom I speak, in the mouth of each who speaks unto me. This day be within and without me, lowly and meek, yet all-powerful. Christ as a light, Christ as a shield, Christ beside me, on my left and my right. And the blessing together, we bless each other. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you, May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen.
Thank you once again, Michael. It's been a fabulous service. We will be breaking out now into our, well, into our individual churches that are there physically. You'll be leaving the Zoom. We'll allow those on Zoom to maybe have a little chat together, but then we'll break you out into individual groups to continue the discussion. It's a bit of a sadness at this point, I have to say, having gone hybrid, that we can't all kind of continue the conversation together. We'll work on that one. We may find a way that we can be in conversation all together. I will try and dive onto a laptop somewhere and drop in and see you all. But we're still looking forward to all being able to be together, but knowing that some of you will choose to remain on Zoom or are in distant parts of the country, we still seek solutions that we can all have that intimate and sharing of our lives together. And so we'll keep coming up with ideas even as we move forward. But blessings on you. Hope you go well. Have a great week ahead.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you.